this guy, all he said was, please pray for me. I'm really struggling right now. I need God to intervene. And so I'm just kind of spoke his name. Oh my God, I don't know who this guy is. I know you know him. I know you know what he's going through. I pray that you cover him with peace, asking the Holy Spirit to come in. Instead of trying to blast off prayers, just ask the Holy Spirit, let him come and tell you what you need to pray for.
You are listening to the Christian Music Archive Podcast, part of the New Release Today Podcast Network. I'm your host, Dave Maurer. Each week, I share stories about Christ, community, and music, chatting with musical guests who you will find listed on the pages of the Christian Music Archive. There are thousands of creative men and women who have helped shape the soundtrack of the Christian faith, and we get to hear their stories, learn about how Christ has made a difference in their life, and hopefully along the way, we'll learn how we can be a better part of our community. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining me again this week. A few weeks back, my friend Janet Bozeman emailed me and suggested that I interview Michael Feighan because he had a new album coming out. I knew who Michael was from the credits on the Christian Music Archive website, but I didn't realize that he had a new album. And when Janet told me that the title of Michael's album was Someone Prayed, well, I was even more interested. If you're a regular listener, you know that prayer is a big deal to me. In fact, I publish a weekly prayer email to help us pray for the people who make music every week. I have seen the power of prayer in my own life, and artists comment about the power of prayer in the work that they do. So I'm excited to hear from Michael about the new project and how his life has been impacted by prayer. Before we hear today's conversation, I want to take a couple of minutes to tell you about another great program run by Mercy, Inc. Bridge to Reading is a program run in 12 Central African countries, as well as the country of Colombia in South America. This program teaches adults how to read and write in their own language, which has a number of benefits. Just think what advantages come economically to people who can read and write business transactions. And in many of these countries, women are marginalized after they pass through their childbearing years, so being able to read and write offers them dignity in the home. Or my favorite story is of pastors who are teaching the gospel but can't read it, so they have their children read the Bible to them. Just think what it would be like for these pastors to be able to read God's word on their own. If you want to find out more about the work Mercy, Inc. is doing through Bridge to Reading, head over to christianmusicarchive.com/mercy. There, you can read about our partnership with Mercy, Inc., as well as see how you can get involved and further the work of teaching adults how to read around the world. That's christianmusicarchive.com/mercy. And thanks for your willingness to help. If you're a fan of the band Whitecross, my guest today needs no introduction. Michael Feighan's high-profile career began when he joined the metal band Whitecross, and he was eventually ranked as one of the top 10 drummers in Christian music, which ended up resulting in him playing for a lot of different artists. But now, he's stepping out from behind the drum kit and stepping up to the microphone with a solo project called Someone Prayed. So, without further ado, join me in welcoming to the podcast, Michael Feighan.
Thank you so much for having me on.
Yeah, it's good to have you, Michael. Well, you've got a brand new album that just released the middle of October. Is this your first solo project?
This is yes and no, because about a year and a half ago when I kind of first embarked on this thing and had a five-song EP, and then had the opportunity to do some more songs with a different producer and just really beef up the production with Chris Lord-Alge, who was like,
Yeah.
So I was, gosh, man, so excited about that.
So is this still an independent project, or did you get signed with somebody, or how did that work?
No, independent. Okay. I was with a company called Label Logic, and their distribution is with Ingrooves.
So to hook up with Lord Tom Alge, I mean, that's a pretty big deal for an indie. Although I think he does a lot of indie stuff, doesn't he?
He does. But I mean, the only way I, besides God opening that door, it was Matt Bissonette produced it, Matt Bissonette and his brother. They're huge in the music industry, and they're really good guys. Love Jesus, and they're in the mainstream. Matt's playing with Elton John right now, playing bass for him.
Wow.
Yeah, and his brother, Greg, who I've grown up, have all his drum tapes and everything. He's with Ringo Starr right now.
That's a pretty good company to run with.
I know. Oh, believe me, I would say, like, I was in that room just kind of going, what in the world am I doing here?
Yeah. Well, for those who don't know who you are, I first got exposed to you as a drummer for Whitecross.
Yes.
And so you've played on almost all of their albums, haven't you?
Well, I joined Whitecross in 91.
Okay.
For the In the Kingdom tour, and was with them up until, I think the last thing I did with them was Equilibrium.
Okay.
And then the band kind of, you know, it was Scott had got, he kind of continued on, but I was going in a different direction, and got back together around 2007. And we re-recorded the first album. And so now you've kind of just been playing, you know, here and there.
Anytime a gig opens up, kind of a thing.
Yeah, anytime a gig opens up.
Well, and then as I was getting to learn a little bit more about you, I read that you drummed a little bit with Oz Fox of Striper.
That was, it wasn't on a recorded project.
Right.
But it was, we had gotten together, was another dream come true. I was a huge Striper fan. That's what really got me into.
Sure.
To wanting to follow this direction of Christian, you know, music. And so it was me and Oz and Les Carlson from Blood Good.
Sure.
And then two guys, Travis McConnell and Logan Ellis from Chaotic Resemblance.
Okay.
And so the project was going to be, we go out and we play Blood Good songs, Whitecross songs, Chaotic Resemblance songs. So it was really exciting.
Yeah.
And we went to, I met them in Las Vegas, and we had a rehearsal and did some photos. And then Oz was just, he was having a tough time with, you know, his health.
Right. Yeah.
And so that kind of put a stop to all of that.
But still, that's a dream team to be working with again.
Oh my goodness. Yeah.
Well, and then I read, you're drumming for BJ Thomas, and that's like the opposite end of the spectrum. I mean, how long did you work with BJ?
That was actually just a one-off.
Oh, okay.
I was living in Dallas, and a worship leader I was playing for, he called me up and he said that BJ was coming in to do an event in our area, and he was needing a band. And so I was like, wow, are you kidding me to play with BJ Thomas?
Yeah.
He was so cool though. I mean, we were backstage just talking through the songs, and you know, we were just talking about his career, and super humble guy.
Yeah. Yeah. Bummer that we lost him this year. That's a bummer.
I know.
Well, you kind of touched on it a little bit. I always like to find out how people really got interested in the whole music thing. And you touched on, you know, Striper was kind of that, that's what I want to do. Talk a little bit about your musical upbringing and how you decided to be a drummer. And of course, you're doing other stuff too, besides just drumming. But where did music bug bite you?
Oh, man, that's a really great question. And it was very... I can almost just see it, that moment when there was like a shift.
Okay.
I mean, I grew up in, my dad was in the Air Force, so we traveled all over the place.
Sure.
And I remember my dad and mom weren't musicians, but they loved music.
Okay.
Always had music going. And I remember my dad had the reel-to-reels, and I'd be sitting on the shag carpet, and he had like Kiss Alive and Rod Stewart.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, this is pretty cool. And I think that's when something like, you know, it was just like the bug was starting to bite me there.
Yeah.
And so I started pursuing drums, and my family was Catholic. We grew up Catholic, and I always knew God.
Okay.
But it was more of like a, it wasn't a personal relationship until about, I think we were in Germany and I was 18 years old. And that's when I really was like, I made a commitment through a friend that, you know, he was asking me some questions. And
yeah.
So I really made a commitment and then started trying to check out some of the Christian music, you know, but I was listening to like Van Halen, Scorpions. And so when Christian friends would like bring me stuff, like Sweet Comfort Band, I'm like, sorry, but that just, that doesn't compare to Van Halen.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. Yeah. So then somebody brought you a Striper tape and you just went, ah, there it is.
Oh my goodness. I was like, oh my goodness. Okay. I get it. And I remember being, it was in San Diego and I was at a 7-Eleven and do you remember the artist Danzig?
Yeah, sure.
I remember I would always go and I'd look at the Metal Edge magazine to see, you know, what Striper's doing. And I remember seeing Danzig was in like a full page ad and it was awful. He was like hanging on a cross and it was just very blasphemous.
Yeah.
And I just remember at that point, something shifted in me. And I was like, I want to use my music in God's army.
Mm.
I want to do what Striper is doing.
Yeah.
And something just switched in me.
Yeah.
From then on, I was like, then I was just on this course. Yeah.
Well, I can imagine you're growing up in your home and mom and dad are both musical. When you decided that drums was the instrument of choice, was that something that mom and dad said, yeah, go for it? It's like, oh no, what have we started?
Oh yeah. It was, oh no, what do we start? My dad would always say, I wish you would have learned the sax. That would have been a lot better.
But I'm glad you didn't, because now you've gone on to do some amazing things, and we're going to talk about a solo project that you have coming out. But I'd love to delve a little bit more into, you talked about being raised Catholic, and you talked about this friend of yours that started kind of bugging you and saying, hey, what was that journey like for you when all of a sudden you realized, hey, Jesus is somebody for me personally, somebody that I can have a relationship with. I'd love to hear that story.
Oh, yeah. I was in a gym. And this guy, his name was Dan Bodner. I mean, this is like 30 years ago. And I remember I think I was tapping on some of the equipment, waiting, to get on another, you know, piece of equipment. And he just came over and, oh, are you a musician? Yeah. You know, and he was the one that said, have you ever heard of Striper? And so he was like, oh, you got to hear these guys. And, you know, then he started saying, so, you know, are you a Christian? I said, well, I'm Catholic.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So, can I ask you a question? I mean, he just went right into
it.
Wow.
Yeah.
So if you die tonight, Michael, do you think you'd go to heaven? And I said, well, I hope so. I go to church every day. He goes, you need to know so. And I was like, well, what are you talking about? And so then he was like, you know, hey, well, let me tell you. And so he started telling me about Romans 10. He goes, you need to believe in your heart that Jesus died for us and God rose him from the dead. It says right here, you will be saved. This is a personal relationship. And it was so bizarre for me, you know, coming from Catholicism. But I was like, man, I said, okay. I said, so you're saying I just say this prayer and I'm saved? And he goes, absolutely. And so he just led me in that prayer. And I remember like walking home and it was like, I was walking on air.
Wow.
It was so bizarre, you know. And of course, then I had to go through all the discussions with my dad that didn't go so well.
Right. Well, what was it about that experience of this friend? Had you been friends for a while?
No.
So he just saw you drumming and came up to you as a complete stranger?
Yep.
So what was it about that clicked in you that said, oh, there's more?
Yeah, I think, honestly, when he asked that question, like, you know, do you think you'd go to heaven? And I thought, well, I hope so. He goes, Michael, you got to know so. And this is how you're saved. And I kind of was like, oh my goodness, I have to do this.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, what's really cool is that later on when I got into Whitecross, so this would be probably about 7 years later.
Okay.
I'm in Whitecross and we're playing, I think it was Creation Festival. And one of the crew came up and said, hey, there's a guy outside the fence and he wants to talk to you. He said his name is Dan Bodner. I was like, what? And so that was so bizarre, man. He was so excited. You know, he's like, look what God has done for me.
That's so cool. For me, that's an encouragement as we share our faith with people and then realize we don't know what's going to happen, but to be able to have, Dan to have this full circle, like you said, and to see that's very cool. That's a fun story. That's a fun story. Well, you, as I've read it, you have started an organization, I think, right, called Someone Prayed?
Yeah, me and my wife, I mean, that's our dream, our goal, to have this ministry.
Yeah.
And my wife always said, you know, everyone, when this song got written about a year ago, and she's like, gosh, you know, everybody has a Someone Prayed story. Mm. She goes, you don't, and it's not just for believers, it's everybody. Because everyone has someone that was or is praying for them, or that you're the person praying for that person. And so we just were like, wow, you know, and we just want to take this solo project and minister to churches. And I think just kind of letting people realize that, like, the power of prayer.
Yeah.
And I mean, like, this morning, three people just came across my Facebook feed. I have no clue who they are, but just, you know, people saying, man, I'm in the hospital, please pray for me. And I'm like, gosh, God, I don't even know who this guy is. Yeah. You do. And praying. So I'm just thinking, how many people have prayed for me that I don't even know?
Yeah.
You know? And so.
So obviously prayer is important to you. And I happen to know a little bit, your wife had some health issues. Was that kind of where you started to really see the power of prayer and to realize how important it was? Or talk a little bit about why is prayer so much that you're dedicating a song and an album and a movement to this, if you will?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, absolutely. Because we had, when we were going through this time, our pastor and good close friends from church, they started a Zoom prayer team and would meet with us every day. And it was for about 10 weeks straight and would just pray with us and encourage us. And I just think, my goodness, if we didn't have that, would we have gotten through that time? Because, you know, it got dark.
Yeah.
And so,
are you comfortable talking about what that dark period with Christy was?
She's kind of private, but it was very, I can say that she was, it got to the point there where she was in a wheelchair, you know, she couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
It was so scary, you know, and I mean, one of the songs I wrote, Joy of Life, kind of talked about that, where, you know, sometimes it's harder to pray, you know, and that's when, you know, people are standing in the gap for you and praise God for his mercy.
I'm finding it hard to be in the present, to be in the now, to enjoy the beauty around me, and not to feel lost somehow. It feels so hard to trust and be so out of reach. Did I not keep close when you gave everything to me? There's a light that shines on through, even in the darkest day, and a voice that calls to you. Don't turn away, Jesus. Give me the faith that will move every mountain and teach me to trust you always. Father, teach me your ways that I want to be my way, and give me the joy of life today. My beating heart fills with wonder that you know my name, and my eyes filled with tears, 'cause you truly love me. You see right past my flaws, carry me through deck the halls. You take my fear away and you're giving me something new. Through the thunder and the noise and the crashing seas and voids, stills my voice, still speaks today. Don't turn away, Jesus. Give me the faith that will mountain and teach me to trust you always. Father, teach me your ways that I want to be my way, and give me the joy of life today. mother's womb, but you know my name, and you know my name. Jesus, give me the faith that will move every mountain, and teach me to trust you always. Father, teach me your ways, that I want to be my ways, and give me the joy of life.
Jesus, yeah, prayer, definitely. You know, just don't know how we would have got through that without that Zoom prayer team.
Yeah. Well, we're a big believer of prayer ourselves, and we're going to talk a little bit about that at the end, because we always ask for prayer requests from the people that we interview, because we believe that people who, we don't need to know personally the people, but God, for some reason, even though he's all-powerful and knows all, still asks us to come and bring our petitions and our requests to him.
That's right.
And so I don't understand why. I don't get it. If you already know, why do I have to ask for it, you know? But that's right. Important. So talk a little bit about some of the other maybe experiences where you've seen prayer be a powerful tool that makes it something that you believe so passionately in.
I mean, oh my gosh, there's so many.
It's like asking which song is your favorite song, right? It's hard to do.
Yeah. Well, okay, like our daughter, me and my wife adopted our daughter Tatiana. Mm. From Russia when she was 8 years old.
Okay.
And that was challenging, you know, very challenging. And I mean, without having God in our life, and just, you know, when things kind of get kind of crazy, and just to be able to go to God and just be like, Lord, this is hard. And finding scriptures to like, and using our words, you know, to speak over the situation, and just having that relationship with God. I know there's always a tendency, probably with my Catholic upbringing, to want to recite, you know, let me just read this scripture right here, as opposed to just being real and, you know, coming to God, talking to him like I'm talking with you. And
yeah,
but that, and even, you know, this, with all the stuff happening today with this whole COVID stuff, I mean,
the fact that we can have a personal relationship with the creator of the universe, and that he wants to be talking with us and interacting with us.
Amazing.
It's just amazing. Yeah. Well, I was looking at your Someone Prayed website and was noticing you had a lot of different people who have been posting little, hey, here's what happened when God prayed for me, and here's the importance of prayer. And I think it's such a good reminder. You know, I often struggle with, well, how do I pray? Like you said, for these people that came across your Facebook feed today, how do you pray for that? So what would you say to somebody who's in that boat saying, I know of this situation, but I don't know how to pray?
Exactly. Oh, I did that this morning. This guy, all he said was, hey, guys, please pray for me. I'm really struggling right now. I need God to really intervene. And so I'm just kind of spoke his name. I'm like, God, I don't know who this guy is. I know you know him. I know you know what he's going through. And so I pray that you cover him with peace. If it's physical healing, if it's mental healing, if it's financial healing. And I'm trying to get better. My wife's really good at this, just asking the Holy Spirit to come in.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, instead of trying to blast off prayers, just ask the Holy Spirit, let him come and tell you what you need to pray for.
Give you that softness of the heart of kind of sensing where the need is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you've got this new album coming out called Someone Prayed? That's the title of it. Yeah. And you said you've got the Joy of Life song on there, which is about the way that prayer has impacted you and your wife and your family. Talk about some of the other songs that are on this project, and maybe even, because if people are expecting a Whitecross album, this isn't going to be a Whitecross album, right?
Right?
It's a little different feel and sound. So talk a little bit about the album and the impetus behind it, the musical style and stuff.
Sure. I grew up, some of my favorite vocalists would be Rod Stewart, Brian Adams, Joe Cocker. And then when I got more into Christian music, I really thought Glenn Kaiser just like, wow, what a soulful gift God gave that man. And so that style is something I've always really enjoyed that kind of melodic rock. So that's more the genre for the album, because I did have some people go, wow, I thought this was going to be like Whitecross. I'm like, no.
You're not pigeonholed in the style you've always done in the past, right? Yeah.
Right. So, and when I had Matt Bissonette come in, he is just a writing machine. Mm. I just was so amazed with this guy. You know, I would send him over ideas. You know, I sent him the lyrics for Joy of Life, and they were kind of dark, kind of just being open about what, you know, what was happening and the difficulty. And when he like said, do you mind if I try and write a chorus to this? And I was like, okay. And it came back and it was so happy. He's like, I know you went through this time, but look where you're at now. So we got to turn it back to where God delivered. I was like, oh, wow. So this song turned into a really happy song. So I'm really excited about that. And Before Time Began, that's about Tatiana, my daughter. Uh-huh. And this one was really cool because I had these lyrics and I sent them to Matt, and Matt loves his boys. Okay. And one of his boys is in Pennsylvania playing on a minor league, the Pirates. And so he just loves his son. Oh my goodness. And so I sent him these lyrics I had about my daughter Tatiana. And I said, Matt, what if you wrote the lyrics on the second verse about your son? Mm. He goes, okay. And so we got that. And then the last verse is about how we're all God's adopted children.
Princess far away in a castle by the sea. You knew she was the one before time began. Those angel eyes alive, she traveled right on time. The heavens opened up, she arrived. If Jesus walked on,
so cool how it just went from one to the other, and musically just that, man, it just came out so good.
Well, so talk a little bit. You wrote some of the songs. You drummed on it, obviously. You sang. Did you do other stuff on the album too?
Well, I actually didn't drum on this CD. And the reason, the first one I did. And it was funny because when me and Matt were talking in the beginning stages of this, and he called me up one day and he said, "Hey, I have a question." I was like, "Yeah." And he said, "So are you planning on playing drums on this?" And I said, "Sure, I can do that."
Yeah.
He goes, "Well, would you mind if kind of pitch something to you?" I was like, "Yeah." He's like, "I think you should really concentrate on the vocals. So we really have this come out good." I said, "Okay." And he goes, "And I can get my brother Greg to play on it." I was like, "What?" Because Greg was one of my drumming heroes. I said, "Greg would play on this?" He goes, "Oh, yeah. He's my brother."
He'll do anything I ask him to.
Yeah. And so I'm actually really glad because we had 2 days in Los Angeles at this really nice studio. And I had about 4 to 5 hours to record vocals. And I'm like, man, if I would have had to done that, track the drums on it, it would have just gotten too crazy. So.
The drums take a little bit more setup than a vocal mic does.
Yeah. Right.
Michael, you have had a lot of experiences in all kinds of different areas, musically and through, you know, some of the prayer stuff and the journey you've had with the Lord. As you look back over your life, and I always ask my guests this, is there a pinch me moment where you go, "Oh my goodness, I can't believe God let me do fill in the blank"? It could be musically, personally, career-wise, whatever. What is one of those moments where you look back and go, "Wow, God, you're amazing. How did you arrange that?"
The one that really comes to my mind, I was in Whitecross. This would have been, I was probably with the band for about 2 years at this time. And they said, "We've got a concert in Rio." And I was like, "Wow, we're going to Brazil. That's cool." And so, let me back up a little bit. Right before I got in Whitecross, I was working at this trucking company. It was an awful job. I mean, it was probably one of the worst experiences. I mean, just terrible got people I worked with, and it was just so unpleasant. And I remember like sweeping the dock one day, and I was looking off the dock and just imagining one day this would be a stage and I'd be like singing or playing to people. And so we're in Brazil, and I didn't realize we were going to be playing in a soccer stadium. And I'm thinking, what in the world? Because we were playing shows stateside, and, you know, there was, I think it was like maybe 500-700 we get. And so we get there, and I was talking to the promoter, and I said, "How many people are here tonight?" And he said, "There's about 60,000. And I said, "Whoa, oh my goodness." And it was Whitecross and Bride were kind of the headliners, and they had Brazilian bands playing throughout the day. And so the promoter says, "Here, come with me." And he took me up to the back behind the stage, and we were just looking out over this sea of people.
Yeah.
And I was back at that trucking company remembering, and I was like, "Oh my gosh." And I was like, "God, you are something else." I mean, it was just a pinch me moment for sure.
So we're recording this a couple of days before your album comes out. I think this episode is going to release the end of the month.
Oh, awesome.
What's the future hold for Michael and the album, and what's kind of the next steps in this solo venture?
Oh my goodness, Dan. That's where I need prayer to just keep my eyes on Jesus. Cause it does. I mean, just being honest and transparent, I mean, I can let the enemy kind of get my eyes off Jesus. You know, why is this happening? What am I going to do about this? Da, 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 da. And I just got to remember, Lord, you know, God, if you've called me to do this, then you're going to provide. You're going to make a way, even if it's seeming, you know, like things are not going the way I thought they would go or I'd like them to go. If you're driving this ship, I just got to trust you. But I mean, obviously I would love to be out performing and ministering and to keep writing more songs and just that whole creative process.
Now, did I read that you are helping lead worship in a church too, right?
I play on the praise team. Yep. So I'm singing there and playing. And
a lot of people are doing that during the lockdown and during the pandemic side of things. And so I'm just hoping that we don't lose all of our good musicians to praise teams on Sunday so we don't have good concerts to go to.
Right. I know. It's so funny to say that because I did. I talked to another friend and he was saying that. He's like, thank God for my church. I wouldn't even be playing anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah. So was this project kind of I'm in lockdown right now and there's nothing to do. Or was there kind of boiling up before that?
Oh my God. This came out of left field. Like nothing ever. I mean, goodness gracious. If I had talked to you a year and a half ago,
yeah,
and someone said I'd be talking with you about a solo project, I'd be like, "What?" I mean, because I was just all about trying to find the right gig and trying to get Whitecross booked, and
yeah,
it was a mentor from my church, really good friend, and I sing at my church all the time, and he said, "You need to do a solo project," and I thought, "Oh, that's really nice of you. I really appreciate that." And he goes, "No, I'm serious. You need to do this." He goes, "I don't know anything about the music business, but go do this and I'll back you." And I'm like,
wow.
And I honestly didn't know even how to begin. And I kind of, you know, I just procrastinated. I was like, I had too much, you know, I was teaching, I was playing locally. And I just thought there's no way I could make time for this. And then COVID hit and my slate was clear. I was like, okay, God, okay, okay. And so I just jumped in with both feet. And now I'm on a totally different path.
Yeah.
And it's just amazing. I'm like, wow, God, I would never have thought this, but I'm so excited about it.
Oh, we are too. One of the reasons I started this podcast is because I really felt like we as a church we're losing what community meant and how to work together and how to pray together and how to encourage each other. And the story you just told of your mentor coming to you and saying, this is something that maybe we're hearing on your behalf. It's the importance of God's community pouring into us. Talk a little bit more, if you would, about A, why did you have a mentor in the first place? I mean, you've got your career down, whatever. But what was it that made that mentor relationship and that community relationship say, there's something in here that God may be pointing you in a direction you hadn't even been thinking of?
Right. Oh, I mean, yeah, community is super important. And as far as like with a mentor coming to me, I mean, it's just hard for me to put in words. I mean, just the fact that, you know, this guy doesn't know anything about music. He's successful in his business world. And all I can think, you know, is just God leading him to do that. And I mean, I hope now it's kind of trickled down to me through our church. We have a mentorship program and there's a little guy that I'm mentoring right now. His name's Anthony.
Yeah.
And a lot of the kids where we live, we're in Crystal Beach. It's a peninsula. And
okay,
there's a lot of broken homes and these kids just don't have, you know, parents are in jail and they're living with an aunt or a grandmother.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of rough. And so this little guy is just, he's a good guy. And they said, you know, who would like to do this mentorship program? So I jumped on, I went ahead and signed up and I thought, man, God, I'm really not, I don't know what to do. Cause I've never done this.
Yeah.
But I thought, you know, I was like, I said, hey, Anthony, you want to do some drum lessons? And so he's like, all right. And this little guy, he has a gift. And I was so excited because I was able to speak into him.
Yeah.
And I said, Anthony, I'm serious. I've been playing for over 30 years. You have a gift. This stuff it's coming naturally to you. I said, this could be what God has planned for you. And you can kind of see his eyes like, man, he's got like purpose.
Mm.
And he's like so into it now. And so, yeah, community is something else. And me and my wife just got to go this weekend. We performed at a gala it's called Hilo Ministries.
Okay.
It was for adopted and foster children. then Saturday we were at, it was called Sabbatical for Women Who Have Lost Children. Mm. So, and this is all through our church and community. So it's,
what I'm hearing you say is, like with Anthony, I don't know what to do with Anthony. I'm agreeing, but you used the tools in your toolkit, so to speak, in this case,
yeah,
drums and sticks, or your experience with adopting your daughter, and that opened a chance for community in another way.
Yes.
Because I think a lot of times we think, you know, well, I don't have anything in common with these people. I don't have anything that I can do. And everything's at your disposal that God's already handed you to be part of that community.
Yeah, that's good.
Well, I sure appreciate your time today. We already talked a little bit about the prayer piece, but like I said, every Saturday we send out a newsletter to about 500 people that are agreeing to pray.
Wow.
How can we be praying for you and the project and your family and whatever's just on your plate? How can we be praying for you, Michael?
That's so amazing. I mean, God bless you and your ministry. I would love prayer just to keep my eyes on God with this project, because, you know, with how it can get kind of stressful, and just to keep that enthusiasm, that excitement, and not let the enemy take it away. And, you know,
yeah, cool.
And just to stay close to Him and let this really be a ministry.
We talked about a lot of fun things today with Michael, but as you might imagine, I'm especially drawn to the exchange we had around prayer. I mentioned this in the podcast, but I'm not always sure why God wants us to pray for people in situations. I mean, He already knows what's going to happen. He already has the plan in place to answer our requests. What is it about our physically asking for prayer that is so important? And how do I pray for requests where I don't have all the details? I was talking with a friend at church just yesterday who said he thinks that prayer is more about the daily conversation with God. And it doesn't necessarily mean we have to use a specific form or close our eyes or whatever. Greg suggested that when someone crosses his mind, he uses that as a reminder to mention the friend to God. Something like, "Hey God, so-and-so crossed my mind today. Would you be willing to be making your presence known to them in a special way right now?" Michael talked about that too, simply asking the Holy Spirit to intercede on our friend's behalf. Then, in my devotions yesterday, I ran across these verses in Psalm 116, and I'm going to quote this here. "I love the Lord because He hears my voice and my prayer for mercy. Because He bends down to listen, I will pray as long as I have breath. Death wrapped its ropes around me. The terrors of the grave overtook me. I saw only trouble and sorrow. But then I called on the name of the Lord. Please, Lord, save me. How kind the Lord is. How good He is. So merciful, this God of ours. The Lord protects those of childlike faith. I was facing death, and He saved me. Let my soul be at rest again, for the Lord has been good to me. He has saved me from death, my eyes from tears, and my feet from stumbling." God hears and answers our prayers, and I'm so glad we serve a God who wants us to talk with Him and share what's going on in our life, both the good things and the bad things. And I'm glad that the Holy Spirit wants to work with us to express our prayers when we can't come up with the right words. Like it states in Romans 8:27, the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. With that being said, I would like to invite you to join our prayer team. And you can do that by signing up on our webpage, christianmusicarchive.com. At the bottom of every page, you'll find a simple sign-up form to start receiving our weekly prayer email. And then every Saturday in your inbox, I'll drop an email with some folks that you could be praying for that week. Before I close today, I want to thank Michael Feighan for our chat today and for the use of his songs Joy of Life and Before Time Began. Both of these songs are used with Michael's permission, and you can find them on his new album, Someone Prayed, which you can find pretty much anywhere you get your music. As always, thanks for joining me for this conversation today. I am grateful that we get to spend this time together each week hearing stories of God's amazing faithfulness. As a regular listener to this podcast, would you mind taking a few minutes and rating it on your favorite podcast app? Reviews and ratings really help spread the word so that other folks can hear about these great conversations. And if you have comments or questions for me, please feel free to drop me a message on any of the social media platforms. You can find me on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and Patreon by searching for @CCMExchange. Or you can always drop me an email on the website, ChristianMusicArchive.com. I'm really looking forward to our time together next week when I have another great conversation with one of the musicians you'll find on the pages of the Christian Music Archive. So until then, remember this: God loves you. In fact, He's crazy about you.